at the time, I thought it was crazy sexist, and it was very like, I'm gonna be me and nobody can hold me back. But then I really later in life had to look back on that, and it's like, he didn't take me to lunch to make me feel bad. Like, he was taking me to lunch because he saw something in me and he was genuinely trying to help me.
Welcome to season 3 of the Amani Experience Podcast. In this podcast, you will experience wisdom, advice, and stories from creatives all over the world. Your host is the award-winning Amani Roberts, who is a DJ, music producer, professor, author, and undercover gamer. On the show, we love to share the stories of creative professionals, especially people who have gone from the corporate life to the creative life. Once again, welcome to the Amani Experience Podcast.
Welcome to episode 137 of the Amani Experience Podcast. For this show, we have Melody Hammer with us. She is the CEO of a company called Loud Lacquer. Three of my favorite things from this episode is that Melody has an interesting perspective since she was coming and used to previously work in the influencer space. So I enjoyed our conversation, and you can tell how that experience works with her current business. Second, she speaks about how in the past life she was referred to as having sharp elbows and how she's just kind of evolved for that. I respect that, and I enjoyed her transparency in sharing that. And then finally, she's very creative. I love how she came up with the name of her company, which we discussed, and just other things she mentioned throughout the interview. You can tell she's very creative. So it was a pleasure talking to her. If you want to reach me, you can email me, podcast@AmaniExperience.com. Follow me on all the socials at Amani Experience. You can donate to the Patreon, which is patreon.com/AmaniExperience. This podcast is sponsored by my new book, which is coming out on April 14th, DJs Mean Business. You can find it on all the platforms and stores where you buy books, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, etc. And if you want to get some special offers, you can text DJAMRO. DJ Amro, text that to 33777, and then get on the list to get some special perks when the book is released and other things after the book comes out. All right. Thank you very much for listening, and to the show we go.
I would like to welcome Melody Hammer to the Amani Experience Podcast.
Hello, hello.
Welcome to the show. We're excited to talk to you. We first do a geographical check-in, so tell the listeners and viewers, where are you right now?
Right now, I am at my own office in Santa Fe Springs in isolation.
That's right. We are self-quarantined right now. Otherwise, we'd be there in person.
Yes.
Tell everyone, where did you grow up?
I actually grew up in Chino Hills first, and then Yorba Linda, so Inland Empire and Orange County.
Okay. And then after high school, did you decide to go to college? What did you do after high school?
Right after high school, I actually decided to go to hair school. So I was a hairstylist in my very early days before moving to Los Angeles and feeling like it wasn't as creative as I actually thought it was going to be. It was a lot of root touch-ups and layers. And so then I moved into the entertainment industry. So I never went to real college, I guess.
Yes, you've been to the college of real life, college of hard knocks, as we call it.
Yep.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, it was a trade school, and I don't want to knock trade schools. I mean, I feel like college isn't for everyone, and there's lots of different paths to success, and I feel like having a trade is something that has definitely been useful throughout my even professional executive career. Anytime I had sort of downtime or was looking for a new job, I went and cut hair. I hustled. So there you go.
Yeah, we respect the hustle. What was your first job in the entertainment industry?
I started as an executive assistant at a talent agency for, it was like actors and directors. Yeah.
Okay. And I know that in the past, you've had a lot of experience working with different kind of influencers and kind of in the influencer marketing game. So I'm curious to know, based on all your experience, what characteristics make up a good influencer?
Oh, that's a great question. I would say the influencers that always rise to the top are the ones that stay true to their voice. which, you know, I feel like is good advice for anybody starting a brand or anything, is to not try and copy what other people are doing, but to really hone in on what you love. And if you just stick to that passion, it'll always be easy to continue to create. So every influencer I've ever worked with who just was really true to themselves rose to the top.
Is there any different advice? Because I teach at Cal State Fullerton, and a lot of the students kind of want to be influencers as well as business professionals. What mm-hmm. advice would you give people who are entering the influencer game right now?
You know, it's a complicated question, because it depends on why you want to be an influencer. If your goal is to be an influencer to make money out the gate, I find that difficult to sort of wrap my head around. I feel like, for example, I started a new brand, which I'm sure we'll talk about, but I put myself as the face of it, but it's not because I want fame. It's not because I want money necessarily as an influencer, but because I actually want to influence people. And so I feel like if you're starting a business and you have something to say and you have a voice, if the goal is sort of pure, then it resonates better with people. But if you're trying to be an influencer just to be famous or to get a quick buck, then I feel like you're gonna die out pretty quickly.
Great advice. Speaking of how you started a new brand, how would you summarize where you are right now in 30 seconds or less?
Where I am right now is I just started a nail polish brand. It's called Loud Lacquer. And we sell nail polish as a commodity, but really more so I would say that what we're selling is confidence and female empowerment and believing in yourself and community. So right now I'm the CEO and founder of it. And we're having fun and making nail polish.
What was the inspiration behind selecting the name? Because I find the name pretty cool and unique. So talk to us about that.
Thank you. Yeah. it's actually kind of my whole persona, which is that, you know, throughout my career, I was a female executive who was fighting my way to the top of a very male-dominated industry. And I was often told that I was too loud, too opinionated, I had sharp elbows. And so I decided to sort of embrace that side of me and create a brand that was uniquely mine and felt like something I was proud of. And I'm not shy about, clearly, I'm not shy about that I am loud and I have opinions. And so that's what I wanted my brand to be, was loud.
And here we are.
Here we are.
Definitely. Don't change. Stay loud. Keep sharing your opinions.
Yeah.
I want to know your opinion on this question. What is important for creative professionals such as yourself or myself to succeed in today's business environment?
You know, I would say that it kind of goes back to the influencer advice I gave, which is really to find something you're passionate about and stay true to your voice. There's a lot of nail polish brands out there right now, and I honestly feel like there's room for everybody. I don't think that there's any industry that is too crowded if you have something to say about it. And so, you know, success is sort of a relative word. You know, what makes somebody successful? How much money you make or how happy you are? And so I think that in order to keep going, you got to love what you do. And there's going to be hard times and there's going to be good times. But if you believe in what you're doing and you love it, then you're going to be successful.
What is your current definition of success? What does it look like to you?
Creative freedom, honestly. I feel like I've had jobs where I've made a lot of money. And I've had jobs where I had a lot of, you know, responsibilities and felt important. But I didn't have a lot of time. I was at the office a lot, and, my ideas were very much, in someone else's voice, and it felt a little constraining to me. So to me now, where I'm at is, I'm a big advocate of running now. And so the fact that I can go for a long run and I don't have to be at an office at a certain time, and usually during those runs is when I become the most positive and have my best creative ideas, and then being able to go and execute those ideas. So really freedom in general is my definition of success.
Yeah, I agree. Exactly. You also spoke about how, you know, competition, your industry could be very crowded. So I'm curious, how do you rise above all the noise and distinguish yourself from the competition?
Yeah, I really am just a huge advocate of collaborating. And even in my own industry, I have other small business nail polish brands, people who do swatches and have Instagram accounts that started as influencers are now creating their own brands. And to me, I don't see it as competition. I see it as we're all creators, and I often collaborate with those people. So to me, it's like they've got their voice and their brand, and rather than saying like, oh my God, they have two more followers than me, that's the competition. It's more not paying attention to what other people are doing and being yourself. And my brand in particular, I feel personally is very different on the outside of other nail polish brands. We try and be loud. We try and have fun. We try and, you know, not take beauty so seriously and, you know, inspire and be a community where we really talk to and engage with our audience and customers. And so to me, we might not stand out to everybody, but we stand out to the people that I'm trying to stand out to. And that's really important too, is not trying to be the biggest day one, but find the people who like your voice and grow that organically.
Exactly. Exactly. I'm also curious because I know that you are really into different colors and different color combinations. What colors are you vibing with right now?
Gosh, you know, like, people always ask me like, what's the favorite color I've ever created? And it's like choosing my favorite kid. You know, it's funny because like the way that my industry works is that we pick the colors we're going to do months out. And right. So I often have two different favorites because there's the campaign that I'm like about to launch that I'm really excited about all the content that we're creating and those colors and what we're going to be able to sort of create with them. But while I'm doing that, I'm also picking colors for the next launch. And so then I get really excited about new colors and like what else can we do and what can we put together. So for me, color is sort of just constantly exciting. And it really does depend on the season. Like obviously, we're coming into spring, and the spring collection that we have, like those are the colors I want to wear on myself.
Right,
and so I'm vibing with that. But then again, like then I find all these other weird colors and I'm like, that's cool too. So I have no answer. I just love
You have no answer, but you gave a really good explanation. So we appreciate that. When you look at your career, you've had a variety of very interesting jobs and positions. What would you consider was the turning point where you're like, this is what I'm here to do and I'm all in?
Yeah, I feel like there's a couple of turning points. For me, I've always been a creative exec for the most part. And so really creating for other people's voices was a big part of it. And in a lot of the jobs that I had, specifically in the digital industry, the creative department is usually the first one to get fired.
Yeah.
It's the first to go. They spend a lot of money, so it's very volatile and it feels unstable often. And so the moment that I was working with an influencer and we created a brand and we were selling a product where I could create content that sold a product, and it felt like the creative could not be sort of gotten rid of because it wasn't publishing, it was for a brand. That's when I really realized like, oh, I can do what I love and create content, but instead of just trying to get clicks and likes and affiliate or whatever ways people are getting money from content, I could sell a product. And that was a huge turning point. But then the second turning point for me was in creating for someone else's voice and, you know, feeling limited and feeling like it was pretty vanilla. And the moment I started creating content that I really loved and deciding that I wanted to have it all, I wanted to have a brand where I was selling a product and the content that I was creating to sell that product was my voice.
Who are some of the creators in your industry and maybe creators in general that you look up to and you want to emulate?
Oh, interesting. In general, creators, I mean, that's such a broad word too, because I feel like in YouTube and digital, Casey Neistat, I just love the way that it feels real. If it doesn't, it's kind of the difference between YouTubers who are very much true to their voice and they're just themselves being themselves, but then the production value of these big companies that I worked at. So I feel like that's a really good example of me personally having been a creative executive and wanting to have the production value, but also wanting it to have an authentic voice. So I feel like he does such a good job at that. If not anywhere near like my actual nail polish industry, but as a creator, I guess.
I agree. His content is very, very high quality and it's very authentic. So I agree with you on that one. Why do you love what you do?
I love what I do because the ideas and the opportunities are endless. I feel like nail polish is paint and it's my art. It sounds so cheesy, but like, honestly, it's true. Like every season, the way I was explaining it to you before, every season there's new colors and new things to be inspired by. And my next collection is actually, sneak peek, nobody knows. My next collection is called California Sunsets. And like the colors, each of them has like a shift to them. So it's like a blue with a purple and then a purple with a pink. And it just really reminded me of how the sunset sort of bleeds into each other. And it's like you can be inspired by anything and then from the world, from life, and create it into a campaign and a theme, and girlfriend loves a theme. And so, you know, any movies or anything that's like exciting or fun, I can create a whole theme around and colors around. So it just feels like my creative soul is constantly just inspired.
Good, good. So I have two follow-up questions for you on that. You said in the past that you love a theme. Why is it that you love a theme so much? Explain that to us.
Oh, yes, I can, for sure. So, you know, it's interesting because as a creative, I feel like I'm not that original. Like, you know, I think that, you know, art is constantly imitating other art. And so finding something that sparks joy in me, like a theme. So we did a nail polish collection where it was a top coat, base coat, cuticle oil, and a matte top coat. So it wasn't colors, it was more treatments. And so to me, it was a little harder to come up with a theme based on the colors for that. But I'm a huge, huge fan of Mean Girls. And it was kind of like this collection was like, they make you perfect. And it made me think of the plastics from Mean Girls. And so I just loved the idea of being weird because that's very much my brand. And so instead of it being Mean Girls, all of the nail polishes had legs on them in our campaign. And they each had like their own persona as a nail polish that kind of went with what they were. And we explained it in a way that was not just like, get your base coat here, everybody. And it makes it more fun. Like themes make it so much more fun because it's like, we're all buying shit we don't need for the most part, day in and day out. And so what makes somebody really want to buy something like yours over someone else's is if it makes them happy and is if they identify or can laugh about it. And really that's always my goal, is I like the high production value, but I also like fun and funny. And so that's one of the reasons that I like a theme.
I love it. I love it. Speaking of the Mean Girls, who's your favorite character from the movie?
Oh God. Lindsay Lohan was probably my only least favorite. Like, she was just sort of the prop in which to be mean to, but like Regina George was amazing. Oh, gosh. I mean, obviously Damien was hilarious. Tina Fey was my favorite character.
Yeah, because,
you know, she was the one that was just real, but also funny. And obviously she wrote it and she's amazing. It's a good movie.
It definitely
shows my age, but that's okay. So I feel like it's one of those cult classics that'll never go away.
It will never go away. It is a cult classic. My next question is, because you have to create so frequently, I'm sure you might run into times when your creative cup might be empty. What do you do to continue to be inspired and maybe prevent yourself from getting burned out or just fill up your creative cup?
Yeah, another great question. Because I, you know, am a CEO of a small brand, I have to do a lot of things that are not creative as well. Finances and, you know, ordering the colors and all of that kind of stuff. And so for me, when I'm not feeling inspired, I don't try to be. I go and do the other things I have to do. Like trying to force creativity just kind of gets me nowhere. And so I try to pivot to the other things that have to get done that are not creative. And then to get myself in the creative space, running, hands down. Your mind is clear. Plus it's just like, I love to create from a place of positivity and happiness and joy, and not, I'm not one of those, when I used to write songs way back in my youth, it was like pain that fueled my creativity. And I'm just such in a different place in my life that I create from a place of happiness. And so running just makes me so happy and it clears my mind, and I get the best, well, I don't know if it's the best ideas, but my favorite ideas from running.
Awesome. I hope you can keep running while we are self-quarantined. So, you know, let's see how that works out.
Yeah. So far, as long as I'm by myself, they seem to say it's okay. So
to be continued. We'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see.
On the flip side, what is something that scares you?
The quarantine? No. for me, the thing that scares me is having a taste of the creative freedom and then having it taken away. And as a small business, it's hard. I mean, there is no easy shortcut to having a business. And I don't have investors to fall back on or a corporate boss to fall back on. It's all us. And in times of uncertainty, which right now obviously is the global pandemic, which, you know, is definitely affecting small businesses, but there's always going to be something. Uh-oh, are we still there?
Yep, we're still here. Keep going.
Yeah, there's always going to be things in life that are going to potentially ruin you. And so for me, my biggest fear is not failure, because that, you know, happens or it doesn't, and you can't control it, so there's no use in worrying about it. It's more that at the end of the day, I have to feed my family. And so if I have to get another job for some reason, I will. And that is gonna be the thing that scares me the most, is having to then not be able to create for myself temporarily. I feel like I will always figure out a way to do it, but you know, life is life. I don't know what the future holds.
We don't know, but we will always figure out a way to be creative. You mentioned failure. How has a failure or an apparent failure set you up for later success? Do you have a favorite failure of yours?
I have a lot of failures.
Pick one.
Yeah, I feel like it's funny. I always joke that I failed my way to the top. I think that in the moment, failure always is obviously hard and is in your own mind everyone else's fault except your own. And I think that the best way to handle failure is to figure out what you can learn from it. And I feel like that has been what has made me continue to succeed, is learning from those failures as opposed to letting them define me, and also as opposed to being the victim and thinking that it was always somebody else's fault. And I think that as a society, we have a really hard time accepting that sometimes it was our fault. And so probably my favorite failure, though, and I'm very pro-female, and I'm not anti-man, but I'm very pro-female and inspiring confidence in women. That's my whole brand. And obviously didn't go to college and was in a very male-dominated industry. And one boss that I had took me out to lunch one time, and this is when I was early in my career, so I was not even at the top. And he told me that he saw a lot of potential in me, but that I had sharp elbows and I came off as kind of a bitch, and that he thought I should, soften my image or the way that I dealt with other colleagues. And at the time I thought it was crazy sexist, and it was very I'm gonna be me and nobody can hold me back. But then I really later in life had to look back on that, and it's he didn't take me to lunch to make me feel bad. He was taking me to lunch because he saw something in me and he was genuinely trying to help me. And so not taking everything as a like defensive and as an attack, and really going back to that moment and thinking, okay, like I can be me and I can be confident and I can have opinions and I can be loud, but am I bringing the best of myself to this situation, or do I need to actually work better with others and figure out how to be, you know, my best self, but also still working well with others? And so it was something that much later I reflected on. And so I feel like in failure, going back even to things that you thought that you were in the right and just thinking, what can I learn from that?
Right. So say, for example, I had this boss just pop into this podcast interview right now.
Hi.
And he was here. What would you say to him?
If you had a boss pop into your podcast?
Like the boss that you spoke to that gave you that advice, what would you say to him?
You know, it's an interesting thing because I've actually wanted to write to that boss and say that I appreciated the fact that he didn't have to take me to lunch. It wasn't something he did with everybody. And it scared me. I didn't know how to take that opportunity at the time and really use it to its best for what it was. So I would thank him. I would thank him, and I would say, you know, it's hard because, you know, he's an older dude and we're in different times. And so I might have worded it differently to not maybe sound so sexist in the moment, but that wasn't his intention. And so my only thing that I would say to him is thank you.
Awesome.
Thanks for seeing something in me and trying to help. And I'm, you know, sorry that I wasn't in a place in my life to really to take it.
Fair enough. All right. We're going to find him and send him a clip from this episode for sure.
Yeah. Right.
As you acquire more achievements, you get more press mentions in the media. You will also acquire critics, or haters, as we call them. How do you handle your critics?
You know, then it just comes back to, there's just things you can't control in life. And that's why I run. And that's why I just, as long as I'm putting something that I'm proud of out there in the way that I present myself, then let them hate me. I feel like you're never going to please everyone. And that is something that I've 100% learned throughout my career, is to stop trying. Who cares? Whatever. People aren't going to like you. But if you love what you're doing, and that's why it's so important to do what you actually love instead of just trying to copy other people or their successes, then they're gonna hate you for like a second, and they're gonna move on to hating someone else. But the people that love what you're doing because you love what you're doing are gonna continue to be there. And so you just gotta ignore it.
Amen. Amen. You're preaching to the choir on a Friday. Tell us about the darkest time in your life, how you got through that, and what did you learn from that experience?
That was a good segue from that last question, because the darkest part of my life was when I was in my 20s. And I was an assistant and then like a junior manager, talent manager. And I was fighting my way to the top. And I cared so much about what people thought about me. Mm. I mean, it was my identity. Like, I had to be the most outgoing and the best at what I was doing. I wanted to be on every list of like 35 or 25. And like, interviews, I made sure that like people knew who I just really cared what people thought about me, and I lost myself. Like, I cared so much about what they wanted me to be that I didn't know who I was. And when my whole career seemed to have gone away, I got fired from that same company with that same boss. He wasn't the one that fired me. Clearly, I was not in a good place in my life at that time. I didn't get fired. My contract wasn't renewed. And so I was lost. I was like, what am I doing with my life? Like, suddenly all of my friends I thought I had that just turned out to be acquaintances. And when I didn't have a job that served their purposes, they weren't really my friends. And so that's the point in my life that I had like a few months that I was able to take off, thankfully, and find myself. And that's when I completely did a career change. It doesn't seem like a career change, but I was a talent manager for comedians. I represented right. comedians and directors. And that's when I was like, what did I love about it? I loved creating content with them. Like, I often would sell their projects and then be a producer on it. And I was like, that's what I love is the creating part. So then I totally switched my career, went back to beauty, which as I mentioned earlier, I started as a hairstylist. So I went back into beauty and I started creating content and left my entire, all of the contacts, everything I had worked so hard to build up in networking and my reputation, just was like, forget it, it doesn't matter. And that was when I was truly happy. And that's when my real career took off.
Nice. You know, everything comes full circle.
Yeah.
What would be one or two tips you would give people if they were in a similar position, like they were so worried about what people thought about them and trying to be what they really shouldn't be? What tips would you give them that helped you kind of find yourself again?
Yeah, that's when I would say staying grounded with, you know, the people who are not afraid to tell you that you're not all that. my family used to call me Hollywood. And when I realized that all of my friends were actually acquaintances, my family was always there. And so in finding myself, it's hard because it's kind of, the advice is, there is no advice. And as a mom, it's something that I think about with my kids too. Like I could tell them exactly how to do things, but you got to learn on your own.
Yes,
so
you
when that, you just got to learn, like, I can't tell you how to do it differently because the only thing that made me successful was going through it and learning from it.
Yeah. Yeah. I understand. Speaking of family, who was the most influential person for you growing up?
The most influential person for me was, I wouldn't say there was a specific singular person. I feel like I took from a lot of different people close in my life. So, you know, my mom was a single mom and didn't go to college. And so I definitely got that hustle from her and get things done. And you never know what life's going to give you, so you just got to keep going. But I would say my brothers were also very influential, and they were very creative and constantly just doing what they loved instead of what they were supposed to do. And so for me, that was very influential for my creative self.
What do you find easy to do that your friends find hard to do? Besides creating nail polish.
For me, okay, let's just mention again this part of the podcast that we are in quarantine. Normally, I would be in an office without my child, but we are here and it is what it is. And so
you're doing spectacular. Do not worry.
okay, so the question was, what do I find easy that others find hard?
Yes.
My positive attitude, I feel like that's just something that is, I'm just predispositioned to have just such a positive outlook on things. And I just don't let things get me down. And I feel like if you can just see the silver lining and the glass half full and things, then it's just so easy to keep going because there's always a new opportunity. There's always something that it's like, I know that there's for many reasons, people don't have that. And so I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful for the fact that like, I am just a happy, positive person. And I try and surround myself, with that same energy and attitude. And I feel like it has, served me well.
What would be the silver lining to what we're going through right now?
Oh, there's so many. You know, it's interesting because, like, again, like, as a small business, I have no idea what this is going to do to me. if the mail stops running tomorrow, the only thing I can do is sell gift cards and hope that people in a few months buy it and that the government decides to, you know, defer our mortgages. And so the unknown is crazy. And it could really overwhelm you. But it's like, we just don't know. So there's no point in spending my energy there and worrying about it because things could change tomorrow. So the silver lining to me is, as much as it seems like I'm just letting my kids sit in the other room, watch YouTube, is the time with my family. Like last night, my immediate family, my mom and my two brothers and I did a digital happy hour where we all got on our computers and We talked for 2 hours, which is funny because we all live pretty close. And like, even at Thanksgiving, we like hang out, but like somebody's watching TV, somebody's doing this. And so it was like, oh, we only can do it like this. We talked the whole time, and people singing in the streets in Italy, and the air quality going back, and really perspective. People realizing that the thing they were complaining about yesterday just had no use for what we are in now, and really making it ground us all, and seeing that when we come out of this, which we will, this too shall pass. When we come out of this, we have this new perspective and opportunity to say like, okay, what was I wasting my energy on before that just didn't matter? And how can I now appreciate where we are and the freedom to go outside and to do what we want?
Keep sharing your positive attitude. I like it. I'm going to adopt some of your tactics as well. So please keep sharing it.
Thank you.
Of course. What would you like to be better at?
Patience.
Welcome to the club.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's part of being so excited and positive and happy is like, I want things to happen right now. And I'm like so excited about ideas and patience is across the board in my personal life and my business life. And again, it's one of those things where when things get delayed, it's sort of out of my control. And that's the hardest for my patients, because it's like, I could yell at somebody, but it's like, what, it doesn't change the situation. So I just got to take a deep breath and be patient.
So. All right. Yeah. Patience is tough. Patience is tough.
Yeah.
When you were 21, where were you living?
I was still living in Orange County. I was about to move to LA.
Okay. So we're going to catch you in Orange County, talk to 21-year-old Melody, give her advice based on what you know now. What advice would you give your younger self?
Yep. specifically for me, obviously, in knowing what I went through, is to stay true to yourself, not care what other people think, and believe in yourself. Having confidence is definitely the thing that has seen me through everything. And it's hard to have confidence in yourself when you care so much about what other people think. And so just not caring about other people's opinions is the biggest advice I would give to anybody.
Yes, definitely. What was the one lesson in life that took you the longest to learn?
Ooh. I'm still learning them. I don't know.
Well, that's good. Share one that's right in process then.
I still feel like it's probably the patience thing is knowing that control, knowing that things are going to be out of my control. And so I'm still learning how to handle it in an actual operational way. Mentally, I feel like I have control over that and not letting it affect my mental state, but it's hard in a business sense to not want to over control and analyze everything to make sure that things run smoothly. And so I'm still trying to navigate that.
Yeah, I can relate with the control thing. Some things we can control and other things we just have to let it happen.
Yeah.
What is one new habit that you've added to your daily routine in the past year or so that has been most beneficial?
Both running and meditating. And they kind of go hand in hand. Sometimes I don't do a full meditation. I use running as the meditation. And having alone time in general in a busy day. And there's always excuses not to go. But I find that if I don't go running because I am busy, then my productivity and my attitude make the day so much harder and longer that if I just carve the time out for myself and focus on myself first, then it makes the rest of the day so much easier. And I just love it. I love running.
How often do you go running and how long do you usually run?
I was training for a half marathon. It's probably going to be canceled now. And so it's a little different when I'm training than on like a normal week. On a normal week, I try and go, like every day if I can, just a little bit, just to start the day and clear my head. But when I'm training, I do at least 3 times a week. And on Tuesdays, I run about 4 miles. On Thursdays, I run about 6 miles. And then on Saturdays, I run with a running group, and we progressively do more and more each week to get us to the marathon. So that varies.
Nice. And then what do you do afterwards to kind of maintain so you don't get tight and start pulling muscles and all that?
Stretch.
Okay.
Yeah. Just make sure that, you know, you, and that's the time it's part of, for me, it's not like the run has ended when I'm no longer running. To me, the run has ended when I've drinking a glass of water right after, stretched. I usually use that time to sort of like look at my phone and see what I missed. And, but like while stretching and multitask a little bit. And, yeah, that's all part of it, and clear your head for the day. So
yeah, great tips. Thank you. Every great person has a sentence. What is your sentence? For example, my sentence is, I love to help people unlock their creativity by teaching them how to DJ. What is your sentence?
Okay. My sentence is that I love to inspire confidence and be a mentor and a positive, this is a terrible sentence. I should have written this down before.
Keep going. You got it. Keep going.
I inspire confidence in others and be the example that I try to create.
Well done. Good job. Now, we're really, really big readers here on the Amani Experience podcast. If there is 1, 2, or 3 books you feel people should stop what they're doing right now and start to read them immediately, what books come to mind?
From a business standpoint, I just started reading The One-Page Marketing Plan, which I love. I feel like it totally changed the game for me, even though like I come from a place of like creative marketing. It is, instead of like giving me a this is how to do it this my way, it's more like focusing your own thoughts and your own creative process. So for me, that was amazing, and just focusing my own marketing plan. So yeah, The One-Page Marketing Plan, very great. I love, oh, am I only supposed to give one? Cause I can
keep just, going. Go, give us 2 or 3, go for it.
Oh gosh, is it called Talking to Strangers? With I love Malcolm Gladwell.
Yes.
So good. I actually love listening to his books because he's got such a great voice, and he makes it sort of interactive, like more of like a podcast, but it's a researched book, which I love. And then I love reading fiction too. Like I'm a big fan of like female executive books, because I feel like I can escape into a world that I like understand and relate
to. Okay.
So like The Devil Wears Prada as a book, I know is a movie, and it's a great movie. But that author has a couple. When Life Gives You Lululemons, I think is her second one to that. And then I'm reading one right now. It's called Ringing the Bell. But it's like her name is spelled B-E-L-L-E, but it's about a female stock trader.
Got it. Okay, we'll add all those to the show notes list. I'm going to add it to my personal reading list as well, too. Great recommendations.
Thanks.
What has been the best advice you have ever received?
This too shall pass.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is my grandma that told me that, and I feel like oftentimes, and obviously where we are right now, is you can't get caught up in what's happening, because it's going to pass, good or bad. So yeah.
Great. Now, are you a sports fan at all? Okay.
I mean, my husband and brothers watch sports, so I like the gathering that goes along with sports, but I don't follow it particularly too much.
So we're going to paint a picture. You've just run the LA Half Marathon.
Great. That's a good sport. I love it.
You've just won the LA Half Marathon. They're announcing that Melody is coming to the stage to get her medal. What song is playing?
Ooh, gosh, that's a good one. There is a song, gosh, I forget who it's by. I'm going to have to double check, but it's the song that I play like when I got my wisdom teeth taken out and I needed to pump myself up, or when I'm going to a meeting, or when I'm running. It's like, I got soul, but I'm not a soldier. Do you know what that song is? Oh, shoot. I wrote it down and then I forgot.
When there's nowhere else to run, is there room for one more sun? One more sun. If you can't hold on, if you can't hold on.
We will find that, though. That's a good one there. Okay. We'll find that and add it to the show. That's a good one. All right. We'll figure that out. No worries. Yeah, for sure. Before I ask you the final question, tell everyone how they can follow you, both on the socials, website, and if you have any special launches that are coming out soon.
Yeah. So we are Loud Lacquer, and I'm going to spell it because I know people don't always know how to spell lacquer, so it's Loud. And then LACQUER. And that is our social handle everywhere. And loudlacquer.com is where you can buy from us directly. E-commerce, nail polish, it's a good time. Also a really good present. And personally, I'm Melody Hammer everywhere. So that's pretty easy as well. And for new launches, I don't know. Because we were supposed to launch spring like next week, but we're not going to, it feels pretty inauthentic to launch a new product right now. So, I think we're going to hold off probably until early April at least.
Yeah, we'll cross our fingers. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, but we're constantly putting out content at the very least. So follow us.
All right. We'll add all those to the show notes. Thank you very much for being on the show. I love your positive attitude. I love the journey that you've taken to get to where you are now, because I know there have been some ups and downs and you've done a lot of cool things before, and how you're using that nowadays, I really respect. So continue. Nice to have met you. We're going to meet in person eventually once this passes, but yeah. Nice to have met you. We let our guests take us home with any last minute words of wisdom or advice. So I'll say thank you again and allow you to take us home.
Oh, words of wisdom. Have fun and be yourself, people. It is a, you know, crazy world and it's full of uncertainty. So just live every day with intention and a smile. That's it. Believe in yourself, have confidence.
Thank you for listening to the Amani Experience podcast. You can check out the show notes on amaniexperience.com/podcast. Please remember to leave us a review on the platform you are listening on, and share this podcast with anyone who you feel would benefit from listening. See you soon for our next episode.